Hello and greetings from Iceland. But in this short update, I want to go over the situation up north. But over 10,000 earthquakes have been detected so far. And it's not just the number of earthquakes that's odd. Those of us who have been looking at the earthquake plots in Iceland on a regular basis know the usual trends. Aftershocks fade out rather fast, although several spikes can be seen as we move away from the largest earthquakes. But this is how the plot looks during the last days. In a way, it looks more like a tremor plot, and the scientists say that nothing is indicating an eruption on the seabed. But they can't rule it out though, since there are plenty of volcanoes under there. But the problem is that all seismometers are situated on the mainland. But like in Japan, it's possible to place such equipment on the seabed, but the cost is enormous, so I don't see that coming soon. And the extremely accurate and efficient methods that scientists have been using to detect land uplift on the Reykjanes Peninsula simply can't be used around here since it's based on satellite data and the island Grímsey is the only rock sticking up around here and simply too small to provide any reliable readings. So this is a way more complicated task than we have had in the south for the last 2 years due to way less data to work with. So literally our experts have no clue about what's going on. But the good news is that things are cooling down a bit. Earthquakes above magnitude 3 are rare and this unrest doesn't seem to have triggered anything else. Although occasionally we see earthquakes on those more dangerous parts of the plate boundaries to the south from the epicenter. But if the plot continues to head away, it's going now, this will be over in a matter of days. But since this is still going on, I want to mention a trend that I've noticed. But when we get strong seismic activity in the north, we seem to get less earthquakes on the south part of the plate boundaries. Like on the Reykjanes Peninsula, that's been unusually peaceful during the last days. But that won't last, that's for sure. I'm also curious to know if the earthquakes up north will cause some more unrest on the part of the North Iceland plate boundaries that are above sea level and erupted 9 times during a rifting episode between 1975 and 1984. And we have actually seen some earthquakes line up along the plate boundaries there recently. It's not much though, but noticeable since we usually see earthquakes there just every now and then. And they rarely line up by the plate boundaries like now. So will those earthquakes we see now trigger something more further south? That's the biggest question. So it's still a reason to be on the lookout, even though we don't see such an event about to hit us as things look now. And I think that this earthquake swarm is fading out now, finally. So let's move to the West Iceland earthquakes that started last year, very unexpectedly. And still go on every now and then. And I made a video when this started where I quoted one of our experts saying that this might just be the first indication that the so-called Ljósufjöll volcanic system might be waking up. But it's however a process that could take a long time. So I added that 90 kilometer long and 20 kilometer wide volcanic system into my list of photo subjects for my channel. And this summer I managed to get a part of that footage in order to cover that system completely. And I've already uploaded one video with some of the shots and I'm linking to it. But to get footage from every major geological formation in Iceland is easier said than done, and it will take me years. But I'm getting there, little by little. The Ljósufjöll system alone will require somewhere around 30 to 50 drone takeoffs in order to present it like I want to do, and some hiking as well. So it is one of my long-term tasks, since I don't expect anything to occur there soon, even though we see earthquakes there every now and then. But to be able to have stock footage during earthquakes and such is just so important for me, so I don't have to use maps only, which is boring. And during my last tour around there, I drove around the Snæfellsnes Peninsula as well, where I captured some shots from Iceland's most mysterious volcano that looks like this with a zoom lens from Reykjavik, but close up it's a feast for the eyes. And bear in mind that this volcano was used in a story plot in a famous book by Jules Verne, Journey to the Center of the Earth, so I have some mighty good stories coming up from there. Despite the lame summer weather we had, I did however use the few chances I got very well and captured some terabytes of footage that will last me through the winter. And finally, I'm shooting in and around Reykjavik these days. And the autumn has been kind so far, with still weather, sometimes sunny, dash of northern lights and the whole package. But the thing is that I've been planning for a long time to make long videos covering Icelandic nature only and edit it with music. And with such videos, I will move into a popular niche on YouTube, usually called Iceland 4K. But it takes a lot of footage and different themes to do so. But I'm getting there, little by little. Or at least plenty to start with to make my point in that corner of the market that is a bit more stable than Icelandic volcanoes. And my channel needs such content, of course. But in this trip south, I didn't visit the volcano that provided us with 17 days of action recently. I only filmed it from the distance now. But to go up there now is in a way like going to a candy store where everything is sold out. And it's plenty of other subjects that will do way more for me these days. Like now, I'm shooting footage for a series where I cover all Icelandic towns and villages. And note that my last episode was about a village by the huge volcano Katla. So my volcano viewers might want to check that one out, or the landscape around there. So it's plenty to come soon. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the earthquake and volcano island, Iceland.